I'm Bonnie Urbay. Welcome to the Contrary's fourth annual film festival, all about women and girls. As a platform for new filmmakers, we highlight the best work, current events about advancing the rights of girls, women, or diverse communities in the U.S., and U.S. women's history. This week's winner is in the category of U.S. women's history. Filmmaker Laney O'Shea brings us the story of a community organizer and philanthropist who purchased a red telephone for her home in South Charlotte, North Carolina, founding of what is now the local chapter of Planned Parenthood.
Oh, well, one morning, on Saturday morning, the doorbell rang. And I went to the doorbell, and I opened the door. I had on, still had on my robe, and there was a young couple there. And that was the one, the woman was working. They were from Columbia, South Carolina. He was in school there, and she was helping him to work to get his PhD or him, well, to get it finished his college. And she was afraid she was pregnant. She was so afraid. So they said, "Is this Planned Parenthood?" And I said, "What there is of it."
Sarah Bryant was born in 1922, 6 years after Margaret Sanger, founder of what is now Planned Parenthood, opened the first family planning clinic in the United States in New York City. Sarah grew up in Charlotte and attended what is now UNC Greensboro and Queens University, then all-girls schools. While still in school, she met and fell in love with a student at all-male Davidson College. Sarah and Bob Bryant, who graduated in 1942, married and started a family while raising two children and earning a master's degree in counseling at UNC Charlotte. Sarah committed her education, talents, and resources to improving her community. She was a founding member of Myers Park Baptist Church, where she taught Sunday school. Through her work with Charlotte's Florence Crittenden Home, providing support and services for unwed mothers and other local health care organizations, Sarah realized the need for women to be able to obtain accurate information about reproduction, regardless of their social status.
Well, way, way, way back, they didn't talk about it. I had a friend in high school who had gone away 1 year to be with her grandmother and dropped out of school. And when she came back, she had a little sister. And later on, when we got old enough to understand, found out it was her baby, she'd gone away and had a baby. And that was the way it would happen. It would be so... nobody would talk about it and nobody would do anything. It was a secret.
In the 1960s, there were still a number of legacies of earlier restrictions. For example, abortion had become illegal throughout the United States, state by state, in the 19th century, and those laws were still on the books for the most part. A law that was passed in the 1870s, the Comstock Law, prohibited the sale or circulation of birth control information or devices through the mail. So that that law had been on the books until the 1930s. It was challenged in a case with Margaret Sanger, and that was off the books. But there were other laws in the states that prohibited the use of contraceptives, even by married couples. In 1965, in a Supreme Court case, Griswold v. Connecticut, that those laws were nullified. So married couples could have access, could legally use birth control. The prohibitions against unmarried women using birth control remained in place until 1972, when another Supreme Court case, Eisenstadt v. Baird, nullified those laws. And so then unmarried women had access to birth control. But throughout this time, abortion was still illegal, both according to federal law and also across the various states.
So it's hard to imagine today that into the 1960s, condoms were never talked about, except maybe men in a locker room, if you had a really good sports coach, might talk to you about protection. But that stuff wasn't talked about and was seen as immoral. This is even before the birth control pill. And so what begins to happen in the 1960s is an opening up of that. Masters and Johnson are sex researchers. What a weird concept. And they write about human sexuality. And that happens in the 60s. The birth control pill becomes available in the 1960s. Women talk about taking control of their own lives and not waiting for men to do stuff. The Feminine Mystique by Betty Friedan comes out in the mid-1960s and said, you know, women, don't be looking to men to solve your problems. Solve your own problems. And so all of this is going on. And as women look into who they are and where they want to be, organizations like the Boston Women's Health Collective put together Our Bodies, Ourselves, which is originally run off on a mimeograph machine. They don't even wait for a printer. They figure out how to do it themselves, cheap. And all of that feeds into this notion that women do not have to be the vessels of, you know, the male sexuality. They have their own sexuality. They have their own choice of their own destiny. National Organization for Women in 1966. Often when people talk about birth control and abortion, they look at Roe v. Wade in 1973, but there's a long effort of bringing those ideas to the foreground. So Sarah Bryan is part of all of that, and that's a really powerful thing.
In the late 1960s, the second wave of the women's rights movement was only beginning to emerge as a force for change. Healthcare and political systems remained dominated by men. In Charlotte, some male leaders who advocated for access to birth control had been proponents of other controversial policies, particularly compulsory sterilization during the 1940s and 50s. In 1960, the FDA approved the first birth control pill, but it was not widely available. The 1965 Supreme Court ruling in Griswold versus Connecticut made it legal for married women to access contraception in 1972. The ruling in Eisenstadt versus Baird enabled all women in the United States to access contraception regardless of their marital status. Never a proponent of eugenics, Sarah sought to make information about and access to birth control available to those who wanted it. Her goal was to educate and empower individuals.
Well, I think Sarah's tenacity was one of the biggest, and I know she's told you the story about how she got Planned Parenthood here, is she went to New York and she said, we need a Planned Parenthood in Charlotte, but her ability to get the community behind her. She went to bankers, she went to doctors, she went to corporations and said, you need to support this. So she didn't take no for an answer. No one says no to Sarah even now. But she went after it and she continued to go after because it was so important to her.
The notion that sexuality and particularly having babies was not something that just happened, but was something that people had some control over. Was a public health cause starting very early in the 20th century. And one of the national leaders in public health in North Carolina was Wallace Carrault, who was one of the first public health officers that any city ever had anywhere. And he was very much at the forefront of all sorts of things, integrating public health care nurses, having public health care nurses. And part of that movement was the notion that people who were not fit to be good parents probably shouldn't have kids. And one way to do that was to provide birth control. But another way, we now say unfortunately, was forced sterilization. And in an era when people who were seen as quote unquote mentally defective were often locked up against their will, The notion of having them not have babies, even against their will, was not so radical. And it's hard for us to put ourselves back in that period, but Mr. Kuralt really wanted a better North Carolina, a healthier North Carolina, and limiting kids to folks who had them, who could care for them and who wanted to care for them, was something that pervaded all that he did.
Wallace Kuralt and Art Jones, a banker and state legislator, came to you and said, we want you to start a chapter of Planned Parenthood.
They said, why don't you? Why don't you start something like Planned Parenthood?
And what was your reaction?
And I said, well, we'll see. And I went up to New York to see what about it. And I looked and they had a map up there with the different places where they had something to do, and they only from Richmond to Atlanta. And I said, we're just like the third world. We have nothing in North Carolina, South Carolina. And so they said, well, why don't you start something? And I had a red telephone in my house that they've made a telephone number for Planned Parenthood. They just had the Planned Parenthood and the number. And people would call me, and I had the privilege of sending them to people like the doctors and lawyers and business people in health care and all that.
Charlotte in the 1960s and 70s really was still a small town. It had a handful of skyscrapers. It had maybe a quarter of the population it does today. There were no major sports teams. And if you were a well-to-do, well-connected person, everybody knew where you went to church. They knew your business. And that meant that if you were well-to-do and well-connected, you knew the movers and shakers, you could make stuff happen. But it also meant that it was hard to make waves because people knew who you were and they were not afraid of telling you what you should be doing.
Well, that was what we did for about a year, and then that's when they told us if we could raise $10,000, we could have a... Because we kept saying so many calls came and that kind of thing, and when these people found their way, we decided we needed a place. And so that's when they told us if we raised the money, we could get a place.
Talk about some of the people who helped you early on. You mentioned Art Jones and Wallace Kuralt getting you involved in it. Who were some of your early board members and supporters?
Well, it was really funny. I said I was either naive or bold or maybe a little of both. And I went to the head people in everything, in the medical services, the legal services, business, community services, education and everything. And I'd say, could you be on my board? And they would say, honey, I'm too busy. And I would say, could you just give me 6 months or while to talk about it? And that's when we met we had a meeting, and the United Way let us meet up there at lunch in their place, the United Way did. And those people became my first board members. We got a doctor's office down on Moorhead Street that had been retired. And then all of his equipment was in the office, and he gave us his equipment. And then one person who had led up my counseling was interesting. She was a nun from Belmont, and she was absolutely amazing. She would come walking in Planned Parenthood with her full habit on, and then later when she didn't have her habit on, she liked to shop. She liked to shop and buy clothes. But she was very good about setting up our counseling services. And so we did that, and that's really how we got started.
I think what Sarah did by being, you know, a sweet little lady from the best side of town, And she loved playing that role because that's really who she was. And she harnessed the connections, the privilege we would say today, to help North Carolina, to help Charlotte in particular, become part of this progressive movement whereby women could control their own reproductive destiny.
Well, I would imagine that in Charlotte, as in other places, even before Roe versus Wade, there were doctors performing abortions. But you had to have a kind of special relationship with the doctor.
Well, that's right. Yeah. If you're a personal doctor, you could do it, but you didn't have it just outlandish. I mean, if you didn't know a doctor to go to, you didn't have a place to go.
So you were dealing with young women who were in some ways desperate.
Yeah, they were.
Mm-hmm. And looking for help that they could not get here.
Well, I think especially for poor women and for minority women, women who, unlike Sarah Bryan and her crowd, her cohort, who might have access to private doctors who could provide birth control and who could provide abortions upon request. Poor women, especially minority women, had no access to any kind of reproductive care, probably didn't have access to reliable birth control, which meant they were more likely to become pregnant. And then once they did, they would be unable to get abortions because they didn't know private doctors, or if they did, they wouldn't have had the money to pay for it. Nor could they afford to travel to one of the states that now allowed abortion. So they were really stuck. Or in many cases, they relied on kind of folk medicine, various remedies, which were extremely dangerous to end a pregnancy. And so they really put their lives at risk.
There were and are folks who feel that the Bible, that the book that they know, the religion they know, does not permit contraception, does not permit abortion, whatever. And they're not shy about telling you that. And so Sarah Bryant was in a milieu where most of her neighbors, if they felt she was doing the wrong thing, were going to come tell her about it. And so it took considerable courage.
Well, not without her critics. Sarah had allies, lots of them. In 1983, Davidson College honored Sarah with the Algernon Sidney Sullivan Award, given for excellence of character and service to humanity. When local opponents of Planned Parenthood learned of this, they criticized the college and questioned its witness to Christian teachings. Samuel R. Spencer, then president of Davidson College, responded in Sarah's defense, stating that, quote, "It is my judgment that if Planned Parenthood and its counseling programs did not exist, the number of abortions would be far greater," end quote. Spencer's characterization of Sarah as a woman of faith with an ability to lead and the courage to engage in difficult work to solve complicated problems has inspired countless others. Sarah Bryant's mission to make information accessible and to provide women with choice has had a tremendous positive impact on our community. A new generation of leaders is continuing her work and answering the call.
Teen pregnancy has been reduced across the country. Teen pregnancy has been reduced in North Carolina. And I think that that's a tremendous accomplishment in our social structure going forward.
Well, I just saw how much those people were appreciating it. They really appreciated it. In the first month that we had our clinic open, we had 30 people to come, 30 young women. And of course, now we give health care of all kinds, as well as contraception and birth control. And it's not abortion anymore, except now and then when they need it.
Planned Parenthood of Charlotte sponsored the publication of The Loving Book. The Loving Book came out in 1971. It was written by two guys. But it was the first popular manual that talked about birth control. And it was published in Charlotte, North Carolina. Last I checked, it's still in print. And so I don't think Sarah Bryan invented that. I think that energy was something that was here. And she said, okay, we can do that. And Planned Parenthood was at the forefront of people having control of, understanding of their sexuality, their reproductive health. Things we take for granted today opened up because of the world that Sarah Bryan helped create.
Well, I think we really have to think about two strands. On the one hand, there was the establishment and the growth of Planned Parenthood, which kind of laid the groundwork for reproductive rights and services at the local level, at the community level. And that was very important. But of course, there were still many legal restrictions on what women could have, whether it was access to birth control or especially access to abortion. But then, starting in the mid to late 60s, the women's movement became active. And one of the main issues that the women's movement addressed was reproductive rights for women, especially including abortion. And so there were demonstrations, there were many public statements. It gained a lot of publicity, really put the issue of women's reproductive rights on the public agenda in a way that Planned Parenthood, especially after the era of Margaret Sanger, really hadn't. I mean, Margaret Sanger had been quite sensational in her time in the 20s and 30s, but by the 40s and 50s, Planned Parenthood had, you know, kind of faded into the woodwork. It was a sort of not especially prominent public organization, but the women's movement really put reproductive rights front and center on the public agenda. But when we look at the approach that was taken by someone like Sarah Bryan, we see a really different set of tactics. She understood that she was operating in a very conservative environment. And what's interesting is that community leaders actually came to her and asked her to start a chapter. And of course, she was already inclined to do so because of her own experience and her own knowledge of the community and the needs of the women in the community.
We're teaching the young people. And as we said, and when I retired, I said, I'll pass it on to the next generation. And the next generation is truly picking it up.
Like a new group of activists that are forming at Planned Parenthood. We work with our Generation Action College groups, campuses. We also work with teens that are in high school that are finding ways to become young leaders and take action on their own in their high school. So I think that in the future, Planned Parenthood's base will shift to represent that of this country. And I think that the young people will be the voice of the future. So I think it's really important that they're the ones that are speaking out, because Planned Parenthood will be here for them.
It's an organization that goes back 47 years, so it's not going away. It's part of a national organization that goes back 100 years. So it's we are not going away. We are doing everything we can to not only preserve it, but to make it grow.
Get involved in anything that you're passionate about, and if reproductive health care is your issue, then find a way to get involved and be inspired by older generations and make it your own. So anything that you do, just make sure that it's meaningful.
What message would you like to send to people who watch this video? What would you like to tell them that's important to you that you think they should hear?
I would say, take a look around you and see what's happening. What's happening to the young people and what's happening to the world, and see where you can put your help and where you can take a place.
Thank you.
We hope you found this edition of our All About Women and Girls Film Festival enlightening. Please follow me on Twitter and visit our website, pbs.org/to the contrary. And whether you agree or think to the contrary, see you next week.
Funding for To the Contrary provided by the Cornell Douglas Foundation, committed to encouraging stewardship of the environment, land conservation, watershed protection, and eliminating harmful chemicals. Additional funding provided by the Wallace Genetic Foundation, the Colcom Foundation, and the Charles A. Frioff Foundation. For a transcript or to see an online version of this episode of To the Contrary, please visit our PBS website at pbs.org/to the contrary.